Hello and welcome to everybody who's here and to everybody who's watching online. We are thrilled that you are here this weekend. I don't know that there's anything else going on this weekend. I haven't heard is a game or something, but we're thrilled that you choose to spend this time with us today. And we are very, very excited about our program. I think some of this music is, in fact, I think all of this music is stunning. It makes me smile on every cellular level that I've got in my body. The first piece on this program, Sunsets Like Childhood, was written, gosh, now it's 2 years ago. It was written as a dedication to two very good friends of the chamber music scene here in Columbus, Ohio. Carol Wilhelm had commissioned it to be written to honor her husband. And in that time that she commissioned it and it was written, but before it was performed, Carol also passed away from cancer. And so the piece was dedicated to both of their memories. It comes from a quote called, "Sunsets Like Childhood Are," now in my brain, pardon me. Sunsets like childhood are viewed with wonder, not just because they are beautiful, but because they are fleeting. And the author is Richard Paul Evans, and the book is called The Gift. It's a short story, and it's an inspiring story, but this particular quote, when I was writing the piece, it resonated on a certain level with the way we have an arc in our lives as well, at the beginning and toward the end. And we all know people in our lives that, as they get to the end of their time here on this earthly plane, some people receive news that it might happen a little sooner. Some people, you know, they maybe, you know, it just happens in the course of time. But there are people out there who live every minute, every second, all the way to the end with joy and with wonder and with awe. And I thought about that is very much in the same trajectory as a sunset. And so in the music, I tried to paint that sort of energy of, you see, the sun is starting to set, and the birds start changing the way they sing. The air starts to feel a different temperature. The sky lights up from one side to the other, and it travels eventually to the horizon, and it's basically a giant celebration of the end of the day, all the way to the end, and right before it disappears, there's an explosion of glorious light. And so this is what I was trying to capture in my work, and in celebration and in honor of so many people who lived their life all the way to the end so richly, I dedicate this performance to them. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, well, it's always a pleasure to be here in Columbus to play for you all. Thank you again for coming. I just want to say a few words before I invite the composer up for the next piece. But John Cziner and I met 9 years ago, I believe, doing our graduate school program in New York City. And we've been friends ever since. And I've actually, this is the second piece that I've been a part of commissioning of John. He wrote me a solo cello and piano piece, which I premiered on my graduate recital. So I really respect him as a person and a musician and composer. So I was really excited to commission a string quartet by John. So let's welcome John Cziner.
Thank you, Ari. 9 years, that's, wow. That's hard to believe. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm John. Before I say a few words about the piece, I just wanted to extend my thanks to all of you for commissioning this piece and for having me here this week. It's just been such a pleasure to work with you guys, and I hope I have been as nice to you as you have been to me. So thank you. What to say about this piece? I've shied away from writing a string quartet for my entire life. Actually, this is my first quartet. It's a scary medium. There's so many incredible works written for this group. And so for me, it was trying to, I guess, find something new to say. I've done that. But for me, it was sort of finding this sort of hodgepodge of various things that came to influence this piece. So you'll notice the movement titles are very dissimilar things. The first movement, Pingala's Mirror, is about an ancient Indian mathematician who is actually the first to experiment with what we know as the Fibonacci numbers. The third movement is a Heartbeat, and it's dedicated to my dad, who's a cardiologist. I think he's watching online, so hi, Dad. The last movement is Whitewater, which is about my experience whitewater rafting as a boy in the Grand Canyon in the Colorado River. So very, very dissimilar things, and I think for me it was how to make these things come together. There's a few musical elements at play. The first note you'll hear in the piece is the note E, and that is very prominent throughout the piece. And to me represents, well, my wife's name is Emily, and the E, first name, first letter, represents something that's very unifying to me. So therefore, the entire piece. The idea of descending scales, which becomes more prevalent throughout the piece, first represents this sort of sunset idea or nighttime descending in the nocturne. But in the last movement, the Whitewater, it becomes the water itself, and all of these overlapping descending scales kind of mimic the effect of seeing whitewater rapids. If you have trouble following along with all of these sections, the one thing I will say, because they move sort of from one thing to another without pause often. So picking up where Korine's piece left off, you may imagine this piece sort of taking off in the late afternoon or around the sunset time. And with the idea that by the end of the piece, we've sort of reached a new day that inspires hope and new energy. So maybe you can follow along with that emotional trajectory if picking out all of these movements is challenging. So anyway, I hope you enjoyed the piece. Thank you all.
Thank you.
Hello. The next piece we're going to play has been a bucket list piece for the quartet for a while. We have something called like a whiteboard, which is digital now, but we write down pieces that we really want to play, and this one has been on there for a really long time, and this program was perfect to add it to. The full name of the piece is called Lift, and it's written by a composer named Paul Wiancko. And he is a cellist, and he is currently the cellist of the Kronos String Quartet. And this piece, Lift, has three parts, and we are going to play the third part for you today, which is split up into three smaller movements, which you can see on the screen as well as in your program. I think it's mainly because Paul is a cellist himself, but he is a wonderful writer for string instruments. And in some parts, he's able to make us sound like a full orchestra. And he's also able to make us sound like not string players at all. And we're going to demonstrate a couple of little things that he asks us to do. And he's also very descriptive in his words, which is fun to read while you're learning a piece. So one of the really cool things is he has us play near the bridge, this part. And when we play up there, sometimes we can get some upper partials or other notes that you wouldn't hear if we weren't playing so close. Korine. And not only does he have us do that, but he has us going back and forth, so you hear them sometimes. Yeah, very cool effect. He also has us do some really cool glissando, where we slide up and down the string, not only when we're bowing the string, but also when we're pitching, which sounds, I think, the best on the cello. And then, again, Ari gets a lot of some of the best extended techniques, you might say. One of them is a descriptive marking, and it says, sound like an old school computer calculation sound effect.
And there's also a dynamic marking that's unusual. Usually we see piano or forte or mezzo forte, but Ari gets cello concerto. So if she doesn't play out, if you don't hear her, let her know after the concert. this is such a cool movement. The three different parts do sound very unique from one another, but they will be going from one to the next. So please enjoy Lift Part 3.
in the late 19th century, there was nobody more influential over what happened in music, in the music, the classical music world in Europe than Brahms. And he ushered in so many of the composers that we know today as these composers who made it, whose pieces stood the test of time. And Dohnányi is one of those people. He was Hungarian and is one of, well, maybe along with Liszt, the most famous people, composers to come out of Hungary. And I think his writing is in many ways about romanticism and Brahms, and in so many ways is pushing the envelope on that. And well, this piece is no exception. Quartet number 2 in D flat major, even that in and of itself is really unique. We were doing some research, and there's one Shostakovich quartet that comes, I don't know, 50, 60 years later than this in D flat major. And other than that, basically no record of string quartets written in that key. It's a key that's hard to play in on the instrument. And that's probably much of the reason that there aren't entire pieces written like this. But it also evokes such a special quality out of what we can do when specifically, well, the nature of D flat major, what makes it so hard, is that we have our open strings on the instrument, and none of the open strings are part of the D flat major scale. Is that right? There's a C. So it's easy for them. Because our instruments aren't necessarily resonating with the sound of our open strings, it means that it gives us much a darker color palette to play with for so much of the piece. And Dohnányi makes really incredible use of that. It's a really wonderful piece. It's in 3 movements. The first movement is, in some ways, a very traditional string quartet, classical, structured first movement. And the second movement, we love. It sounds like this sort of like spy thriller movie to us. And then the third movement is by far the longest of the 3 movements, and opens with this incredible prayer, and has a very lively middle section. It's a really special piece for me. I think it's a really wonderful thing to get to remember certain moments in our lives through the music that we hear. And I'll never forget the first time that I heard this piece. It was in the beginning of when I had moved to San Francisco, and it in so many ways, well, we don't have all of the time that I have to say the whole story, but it was really important to me in the way that it shaped the music that I was making right when I moved, and I'm so happy that we get to share it with you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.